Hey y'all, I'm not sure if you know this about me, but I read a lot of books, like over 100 books a year. And I have this really tough moment sometimes where there's something that I read in a book and I can't remember where it is. And I'm trying to go back through all the books on my bookshelf to try to remember what it was, and it's really frustrating. When we're in that situation where we're looking for something and we can't find it, there are two ways that books have set up for us to make it easy for us to find the information that we're looking for. And those two structures within most books are your table of contents and your index. Your table of contents makes it easy for you to remember where things could have happened in the book. It usually gives you sort of a structure to the book, whereas an index, especially in a more academic book that has those indices. They have a way that you can look up just a specific idea or a specific concept and be able to figure out what page that is on. We can take that same idea of having a table of contents and an index and apply it to your website. So that way it's really easy for your visitors to figure out what it is that they're looking for. If they've been there before, they can kind of retrace their steps a little bit. And if it's their first time, they're able to browse around and see what it is that they're looking for. The ways that we can organize our website with a table of contents and an index is by using categories and tags in order to make it easier for people to navigate around the site. So in this video, I'm going to explain the difference between a category and a tag and when you should use them and which of them you can skip and how you can make it easier for people to work their way around your site. Hi, I'm Meg Casebolt, the founder of Love at First Search, where we help online entrepreneurs to show up in search results and then turn those new visitors into leads, subscribers, and sales. This week, I'm going to be talking about how you can structure your website in order to make sure that people can navigate around it easily and find exactly what they're looking for. And the way to do that is by using categories and tags. Now, the best way that I have to describe this is that it's like trying to find a recipe in a cookbook. Look at me, I have props. Every cookbook is going to have a table of contents that tells you exactly what to expect in the different categories that are going on. And then you can actually skip right through to the specific categories because it has these little tabby things on the side. So when I'm looking for desserts, because I'm always looking for desserts, I can easily figure out exactly which page I want to be looking at. But if I know that I want to make chocolate chip cookies and I just want to skip to anything possible that has chocolate chips in it, then I can go all the way to the back, go to the index, figure out which pages have chocolate chips listed as one of the ingredients, and just look at those pages, which may be in the cookie section or they may be in the dessert section. And I don't necessarily know which category to choose from. I just know that I love chocolate chips. Now I kind of want to find all the chocolate chips and I'm getting hungry. Ooh, chocolate chip bars, cakes, ooh, date cakes with chocolate chips, gross. Your website should be able to work the same way. You should have specific categories that people can click to, and it's almost like you have little tabs for them to be able to figure out what they're looking for. And that's how you're gonna use the categories on your site, is if you have specific topics that you're always talking about and you can find ways to group them together so that way people who are looking for that specific idea can go directly to what it is that they're looking for. And then you can have the equivalent of chocolate chips in your website. The tags that you're going to use to make it easier to find specific topics, even if that's across multiple categories. Now, I'm not going to be able to tell you what your categories on your website should be because that's sort of up to you. The categories that I'm going to find in a general cookbook are going to be different than the categories that I find in a vegetarian cookbook because the vegetarians aren't going to be including lots of different meat choices. They're going to be leaping more into specific vegetable types or different dairy products, right? And the more specialized your website is, if you're doing the website equivalent of just farmers market desserts, there's going to be a lot of vegetables that you're not going to include because no one wants to put Brussels sprouts in a dessert. Gross. So if you're trying to figure out what you want your categories to be, think about them as the top 7 to 10 topics that you're talking about all the time, that you know people are looking for, that you know you're well known for. If you already have content on your website, maybe try to map it out and figure out what are those topics that you just keep talking about over and over again. And remember that even across the same industry, you may not end up having the same categories as other people who are talking about the same things you are. For example, if you go to Search Engine Journal, you would assume that their categories would be similar to what mine are, because they have all of these different SEO topics, but I don't have any particular category about core web vitals or, you know, Google EATs. All of my categories, they're a little bit more generalized. They're content strategy, they're specific tools, they're analytics. And then sometimes they're even more specific because I love talking about podcasting, and that's not something that's specifically on the Search Engine Journal website. So figuring out not just what are the categories that everybody's talking about, but what specifically is it that you are talking about that is relevant to your audience. It might look different than other people in your industry. Now, I told you to try to stick to 8 to 10 categories on your website. Maybe you're already at the point where you have more categories than that, or maybe you're kind of trying to brainstorm what they could be and you're not sure what they are. Or maybe you're like me and you used to talk about something else and you had a category and then you pivoted a little bit and you're not exactly sure how to consolidate back down to those maximum 8 to 10 categories. That's okay. What we need to do here is come up with a strategy to either consolidate your categories or to build out subcategories. So in the case of Search Engine Journal, they have these main categories of SEO and PPC and content and social, and then they have more specific categories underneath that, those subcategories. And the same is true for my site. I obviously don't have nearly as much content as a giant media site like Search Engine Journal, but I used to be more focused on web design and not so much on search engine optimization. And so I had a whole category just about branding that was only about logo design and brands and brand strategy. And that's not really what I talk about anymore, but that content is still good. So I rolled it in to be a subcategory of my web design category. So if you're in this boat of having already created a bunch of categories, feeling a little bit overwhelmed by how to organize them on your site, maybe try to come up with some bigger umbrella categories and then create subcategories underneath those. Now, I know that talking about different SEO terms is maybe a little bit boring and not as clear to understand as something that we're all looking for all the time and trying to organize ourselves around. So let me share an example with you from one of my team members. Her name is Allie Mitchell, and she runs the Plant-Based and Broke blog. Now, Allie's specialization here is that she helps people to come up with vegan recipe choices that are not particularly expensive, and to help people also cook well with just a bit of creativity and grace, which I love that mission statement for her. Now, when you get to Allie's recipe page, you can see that right here, she has all of these different categories that are right here for people to organize and know what it is that they're looking for. So if I'm looking for a vegan dinner recipe, I can just skip right over all of the stews and sides and snacks, and I can go right to just the dinner recipes. And then depending on what it is that I'm looking for here, there may be something that just, you know, catches my eye. So I love that Allie has this sofritas recipe that has the tofu from the Chipotle menu right on here. And you can see that she's got it categorized as dinner, so it would show up in that dinner category. But also when I scan down here to the bottom of the post, you can see that it's got the category of dinner and also soups and stews, but then she's got tags here for things that are gluten-free, high protein, Mexican food, using tofu, using Chipotle, but also tapping into that Chipotle brand here. If I wanted to go find more high protein foods or more foods that have tofu in them, then I can just go find that particular ingredient. It doesn't have to be only tofu dinners. The tags carry over across the category, so it's just things that are gluten-free. I can see all of her gluten-free recipes, all of her tofu recipes by clicking on that without being limited to a certain category. Tags can hit way more than just one category, and they can be a lot more specific than their category counterparts. So now I'm going to answer some rapid-fire questions about questions that I get all the time about categories and tags. Here we go. How many categories should I have? There is no minimum number of categories, but I would like to think that there's a maximum of about 8 to 10. What if I have more than 10 categories? Totally normal, especially if this isn't something that you had a strategy for in terms of the plan of how you were gonna organize things on your site. So if that's the case, then look at your categories, maybe try to consolidate them down, maybe build up some subcategories, find ways to get yourself to a place where people can navigate through your site without getting overwhelmed by the number of categories. What if I'm just getting started and I can only think of 3 categories? Great, go with 3, go with 2. Over time, you may end up realizing that you're expanding outside of those original categories and just add them on one at a time. You don't have to have the entire strategy in place to get started. Start with what you want to be found for and then start to build slowly. Do I need both categories and tags? No. Absolutely not. If you don't have a really clear idea of how your categories are going to be different than your tags, then just skip the tags, okay? There are so many websites that don't have any tags on them, and they are doing just fine in terms of SEO and in terms of navigation. So tags are sort of optional. In fact, when I was looking for examples of websites with tags, I had trouble finding them. So don't feel like this is something that you need to do in order to make sure that your posts are complete and your portfolio's done and your products are good. If you're not sure what to do, either skip it entirely or give me a call. Head over to Love It First Search. We can have a conversation about what your category and tag taxonomy strategy can be. Can I have the same phrase as both a category and a tag? No, please don't. Please. Let's keep our categories as big picture umbrella topics that you're talking about and tags as more specific. The problem with having the same phrase as both a category and a tag and then tagging everything the same and putting all the same things in both the category and the tag is now you have two pages on your website with all the same information. And Google's not going to know which of those to count for. And then it's going to go, well, I don't know where to go. And confused Google, just find something else. So keep your categories broad, get your tags really specific. What's the minimum number of items that you need in order to create a tag? I say at least two unique items for a tag. So you don't want to have a tag that only has one item in it, whether that's a product tag or a post tag or a portfolio tag, because then instead of people finding that product in search, they're then finding the tag that has the product, which is not helpful in terms of navigation. We also don't want to have tags that are so similar that they have all the same items within them, because then Google again is going to be like, wait, but which one am I supposed to send them to? I don't know. So make sure that you're not duplicating tags. On Allie's blog post, she had a tag for tofu. She doesn't also need one for tofu protein, but she may want a different one for tempeh. She has a tag for Mexican. She doesn't also need one that's called Mexican food. That would be duplicate. You would just tag everything the same. May as well just keep it simple and have fewer tags and be able to add more to them. Where should I display my categories and or my tags? If you have a site with either a lot of content, especially a media site, or you have an e-commerce site, I recommend putting your categories into your main menu. I have a whole video about how to set up your menu if you want to learn more about that. You can also include your categories in your sidebar so that way people can see the topics that you talk about a lot. They can go through and find just the categories that they're curious about, and then also make sure that it's in your post and product templates so that when you publish a post, it has those categories right built in there. And that way people can click through and find out more about them. And your website can use that information to share related content and increase your internal linking. And there's a whole nother video I have about just internal linking that I'll link to right here. Can my category pages and tag pages actually show up in Google search results? Yes, they can. Now, it's probably not going to show up in search results if you leave the default settings. If all you have is the word of your category and then it just says archive, then chances are you're not going to get too much traction on it. But you can optimize those category pages and tag pages the same way that you would optimize a blog post or a product listing. So on my website, I have a category all about analytics. And anytime that I talk about any sort of tracking or marketing measurement, I make sure to include it in that category. But I'm not just naming the category Analytics Archives, which is what the default setting would be for that. I went in and I called it Google Analytics and SEO Resources. And I wrote a description underneath it that says, you know, if you're looking for help with your analytics and you want to know what's working in your marketing, come check this out. That way that text shows up at the top of the category page and Google has something that it sees as different from what is in those blog posts. That's a little bit more broad, more open, talking about everything you can expect in that category. Another thing you can do with your category descriptions is actually include links to the most popular products or posts in that category. So for example, on Allie's website in the dinner category, she not only has a description that's full of keywords about being kid-friendly and protein-packed and made quickly, but she also has links to her top recipes in that dinner category, like her vegan mac and cheese and her tofu nuggets. She knows that those are some of her best-ranked and most popular dinners, and so she wants to include those in that category, start to drive traffic to something that she knows people will love. And finally, are there any best practices for naming your categories? Yes. Keep it as simple as you can. You don't want to have categories that have like lots and lots of words in them, even tags as short as you can keep them. So that way it's easy for Google to understand what's in there. And choose whether you want it to be singular or plural. You don't need to have a category for dessert and a category for desserts. Just make sure that you stay as consistent as possible. Always think about adding more to existing categories and tags before you create new ones. This is the final video in our 5-part website organization series. We started with an explanation of how to kind of set things up on your website to make it easy for people to move between them. We talked about what to put on your homepage. We talked about what to put into your website's menu. Might be a little different than what you're expecting. We talked about how to link between your pages, and now we're talking about categories and tags. If you thought this video was helpful, make sure to like and subscribe so that way you're able to get any future videos we create about how to make sure that your website can bring more organic leads into your business.